intro on the car. It's so tacky. Do it on the brainer.
No. No, we'll do the intro now.
Okay.
We're live.
But everyone that does it in the car, you're just like, you're in your car, bro.
Yeah, but it's cold out there. We're doing it. We're like, actually, this is the intro.
Why did you pick the coldest November day in history?
To pull pots. Alright, so like there's a few things that me and Maddie don't do a lot of. And I'm from like a crayfishing family almost, because most of my family is from Jurin Bay. But one is pulling pots and the other is squid fishing.
I hate pulling pots, mate.
You're doing it. No, but he's got a deck winch on board. We're gonna jump on a mate's boat and the whites are running, and so it's always exciting when the whites are running to go and do it. But when it comes to crays, if I want to get them, I normally want to get them diving. But it is pretty cool pulling a pot with like 20 crays in it. So we're going to jump on board with him today, have a bit of fun. Interesting fact, crayfish can technically live forever.
Yeah?
Yeah, so they've got, they can basically endlessly repair their DNA. That's like a true fact about crayfish. The only reason they generally die is because something kills them, like us.
Sucks for them, they're so delicious.
That's right. But they mainly die when they get to about 100 plus years old because they don't have the strength to molt. They can't get enough food to create the next molt.
Okay.
So we're going to catch one today. We're going to continually molt it over generations and create a Leviathan god lobster.
If we go all the way to Two Rocks and catch one crayfish Kepler, I'm never fishing with you or your friends ever again.
Not be the first time. Anyway, it's going to be a fun morning. Freezing cold. Can't wait. Let's do this.
Righto guys, so we're back on the water, and as Kep said, a little bit different today because we're pulling pots, which I absolutely love. If you didn't hear the sarcasm in my voice just then, you wouldn't pick up on the fact that I hate pulling pots. But we've got the fishing rods on board. Greg's taking us out. Say g'day to everyone, Greg.
Yeah, everyone.
Kep looks happier than ever too. You going all right there, big fella?
Yeah, I'm on the water, I don't care.
You had a few drinks last night while we're here.
Yeah, I'm all right. That's
a lot of water. Look guys, just hang in there because we're going to go and find some fish. We're going to pull some pots. We're going to make it a bit interesting today, so can't wait to get into the action. As you can see guys, we're out off Two Rocks today and it is absolutely cranking. Every man and his dog's out here with a pot. Good news is, people back at the ramp were saying that there's full pots of cray. So provided Greg knows what he's doing, we're gonna have a good feed. You gonna cook these things later or what, mate?
Yeah, I reckon we'll get them on the barbie.
Yeah,
I'm pretty hungry already, so I'm looking forward to this one.
So I reckon the white crays are probably the tastiest. They've just molted and there's none of that like sort of thick, yeah, that thick membrane on the older crays before they molt.
Yeah,
all gone, nice and clean. I reckon that they're slightly different.
Not a bad start. Not a bad start there, guys. Have a look at this. A couple of cackers, but I can see a keeper.
It's all right.
That's a keeper.
That's a nice white.
Gonna bait this pot, drop this one. How many pots we got in, boys? Four?
Yep.
Four pots to check, so she should be alright. This hard work stuff's not our gig. How you going there, Maddie?
Good, mate, yourself?
Yeah, good.
Excellent. Could get some hockeys today, you never know.
Give me a pot full of wobbegon, mate, and I'll be happy. So I know I've been whinging all day about cray fishing, but I'm on the sea, guys. This really doesn't get any better. It's not like we're 12 nautical miles offshore chasing crays and pulling pots. I'm gonna go ass up if I'm not careful here. I'm standing right on the back of the boat, but I'm trying to give you the best view of what's going on. Geez, you got a tough gig over there, Greg.
Someone's gotta do it, mate.
Yeah. All right, we're good.
So we're just about to get the next pot, guys. And let me just tell you, our whites here in WA, I don't know what it's like in the rest of the world with the lobster you catch over in America and other places, but they walk in huge numbers. So there's nothing technical about catching them. This time of year, you drop your pots literally on the edges of inshore rock and weed, and a lot of guys just throw them straight in sand in between lines of reef. And the reason for that is, even if your baits get eaten out, when the crays see the sun coming up, they're gonna pile in the pots. And again, I've heard of people this time of year not even using bait, just putting the pots in a location where those whites are gonna find cover. So, as you can see, we're just offshore. We're not even a K out here. And the first pot had a few crays. We'll get the second one up now, let's have a look. I can just see the froth in Kepler's face. He's like, give me crays, baby.
For
you,
baby. Oh, yeah. Sinker.
Watch that tipper, mate. Put your hand, left hand on that tipper. Roger, ready?
Yeah, just give us a bit of slack. Yeah. All right. Hang on.
Electric winch. This is a lot easier than back in the day when I was pulling them. For anyone that doesn't know me, yes, I've pulled a lot of pots, and that's the reason why I always whinge about it. It's a shit job. Not when you got one of these, though. That makes it a bit easier. What do you even do for your money, Matt? I mean, this is too easy. I used to have to pull them by f***ing hand, mate.
Mate, have you seen these guns?
That's a better pot, lads.
Done well, that pot,
that's a cracking pot, lads.
Some serious craze coming in the boat. This is only pot number two, guys, so I'm actually looking forward to the next couple of pots. There's licenses all around on board here, so we're actually going to take a fair few craze today. Now, the reason these sinkers are going on the line, guys, is purely for boating traffic. Now, it keeps the ropes way down. It doesn't allow the ropes to float out and away across the surface. There's nothing more frustrating as a fisherman than you pull up your spot and you've got ropes everywhere to contest with. You're trying to punch in through swell and you're trying to drive. You don't want to snap your prop on a rope. But this is good. Like, everyone's starting to adopt it now. Sinkers on the ropes or a lead weight, and you got a lot more happy people in the water.
Won't
so Kep's doing the check right now. We're looking for tar spots. Quinny showed us in previous videos what we're looking for. A, we're looking for female, male, tar spots, eggs, obviously the size limit, and then we're going to do the tail snip as well. So plenty of work to be done when you're looking for crays, guys. It's not as easy as just going out and getting them. You need to know your stuff.
I want some structure, then I want to be on the western side of it, on the sand.
Yeah.
So when they haven't started walking, I want to be close up to the reef. When they start walking, I want to take it further out onto the sand. But I want some good structure first. Some caves, some ledges, something for them to store up on.
Looking at an ideal world, guys, if you're chasing snapper today. There was a couple of meters of swell coming in and a little bit of a storm front the last day or two, and the water is like soup. I would absolutely be frothing right now for snapper, but can't take them, can't touch them for another couple of weeks yet. Here in Perth, we're right in the middle of a demersal ban, which means we can't touch anything that's decent eating other than your bread and butters. But look, there is some flogies getting around. I saw a dirty water line just back out of the boat ramp, so it might even be worth chucking in a couple of lures and trolling around for mackies on the way back in. Right, so Greg was just saying that we got these pots in and around a little bit more structure, guys. So this is the last two pots, and feeling pretty confident at the moment. Not that the boys are going to give me any craze, because I've literally not lifted a finger.
You'll be cleaning them.
Hey, craze in there, lads. That's strong.
Beautiful coloured whites. They're all coming in size by the looks of it.
I'm just checking basically from the horn to the back tail. You can see his size, and that's it.
Yeah.
It's not a tar spot. It's not buried. It's a keeper.
And Greg's just clipping the tail. Greg's just clipping the tail now.
Yeah.
And that one's ready to go.
Okay. Easy.
There you go.
Yeah.
Doesn't fall in within the requirements, so hopefully he'll be a bit bigger next time.
And again, guys, you must release these crays within 5 minutes of... look at this idiot, he's just powering across the surface. That's bait. But anyway, you must get them back in the water within 5 minutes of pulling them out, guys, and that's what happened here. This pot came straight on board, bang, measure them up, straight in the water if they're undersized. Luckily, we've only have one or two undersized at the moment.
Looking good.
Righto, guys, so what we're going to do, we're going to leave the cray fishing there. We've had an absolute cracking morning on that, so hopefully some screaming drags in a second. Let's see how we go. All right, guys, so I've got the hard job this morning, obviously, catching the bait. And what's going to happen is I'm going to catch all the bait, and then every other rod on board is going to take off for the fish, except for mine, when we get to the bigger stuff. It just happens all the time.
We're targeting whiting for sambos here, Matt.
Because herring, you've got to wait till bite time to catch herring. Whiting, you normally don't. And you know what? I'm really not having that much success. I don't know these grounds, though, so I'm blaming everyone on board except for me. Two Rocks is not my area to catch whiting. But yeah, no, I've literally found that whiting will bite generally all day long. The smaller ones will bite pre-bite period, the bigger ones bite period. But you really want the smaller whiting for liveys anyway. It's just a way to go.
This is boring as batshit.
You won't be saying that when these little lollipops are pulling us in 30 kilo sambo.
The problem is you cut the one whiting up that we caught to try and catch whiting, so you better make it happen.
Hey, I've got one already, bro.
Really?
Stress.
Oh, my God, it's pulling tons of drag. Look at that.
I've actually got that drag really loose. I don't know why.
Oh, here we go.
Oh, you're joking.
It's a flatty. It's a flatty.
Do you know what the good thing about these are? They're normally in schools of about 10,000, and you go home and you can't close your hands after you try to remove them from the hook. Just from getting spiked. Look at this. No, shit you not. Nature was taking the piss when they gave these flatty spikes. Look at those spikes on the side of its head. Like, they're bigger than the big ones. Anyway, enough whinging. Let's catch some bait.
Guys, do this for a living?
No. We'd be very broke.
I've legit spat the dummy. I've just like kept you out of the rod. I'm trying to catch sand whiting and doing an absolute butcher's job of it. So, you confident, mate?
I reckon I'll get one.
I just don't reckon you will. I reckon he's so full of himself. He reckons Matty couldn't catch one. I should be able to catch one. It's actually not that easy, bro.
I feel like you've taken me onto the reef, though. I feel like you've moved me out of the
tank. Oh, listen to the excuses. At least I could tell you when I can't catch them. And he's reefing in the double headers.
I feel a crayfish. There's a crayfish on this. I feel it. Oh, I pulled it out of his mouth.
Oh, yeah, they do that, don't they?
Bastards.
No one believed me when I said that was coming out of their mouth.
Well, considering that's the size of his mouth.
And that was one of the big ones now, I'm telling you. I got the biggest one down there. I'm going to bring it in. I've got a fish on here.
I got
How'd
rake.
You go?
I got cleaned out.
Look at that
cleaned
fish. That was a huge one.
Oh, look at him. Show everyone the lolly that you just got us.
Right, so... Oh. I'm not going to lie and pretend that I'm a... Well, where's the camera?
Yep.
I'm not going to lie and pretend I'm the whiting expert of the world, but I'm the whiting expert of the world.
Those real monsters, those kidney slappers.
I told you that's the size we wanted for bait, mate. It's specifically targeting tiny whiting.
Which is great, because, I mean, if anyone's good at targeting smaller fish, actually, I won't go there.
And then thick and fast now. How good's that? This is the best part of my day so far. Pulling pots. All right, so we've got some birds working the water, guys, and the sambos don't seem to be firing up this morning. There's just no, we're not seeing anything on any lumps around here, so we've made the decision to sting over to the birds and see if we can't pop a tuna or whatever's in there. It could be mackies, could be tuna, could be anything. That's what's exciting about it, you just don't know. So I've got some little stick baits. I've got a little golden stick bait that's, this thing is dynamite for small pelagics. Look at that. ripper. I am going to trim that tab off. That looks disgusting, but once we get over there, I'll punch it at them.
Oh, they're just on top of us right now. Oh, I can see the school zone. This is it. This is the hookup.
Yep. Got it.
Way, let's go. Yep, swap. Oh, he's come off.
Oh, you're kidding.
Fucking hell.
Why am I never casting when they're right at the boat? Always f***ing around with the camera. Right, that's pretty typical of a Perth bite, guys. The tuna came up for a couple of throws. We literally had four throws. Kept hooked up twice. I was worrying about the camera twice. That's my excuse anyway. So I didn't hook one, but we lost two fish.
I must have had blunt hooks because they just kept coming out. But the first fish was a tail wrap and it just sort of shook itself free. And then the second fish, just came out nice and easy. They were pretty big tuna for Metro.
Metro tuna, they were.
They were pretty good size, so they were good fun. I don't care about losing them that much. I really enjoy hooking them though.
Well guys, it's the end of the day as well, so we really need to see another school or something pop up. Like I said, Sambos, nah, they were dead. It's probably the wrong time of day for Sambos now. But if they pop back up, we'll try again.
Well, there you go. We came out. It's a bit harder when the demersal band's on. You can't target everything you want to do. But we got out. We got into a couple of fish. Didn't actually land any, but we had a bit of fun with them. But for me, what I really wanted to do was come out and see the whites run. It's a pretty famous thing around Perth. When it happens, everyone goes mad. The crays fill the pots, and as you can see, we've bagged out. So we came out to do a bit of that, have a quick fish. Didn't happen on the Sambo Kingy front, but we're just going to keep popping out and having a bit of fun with it. Today was good, and basically going to head home now with these crays and show you guys a really simple, delicious dish that I used to have on at the pub, which is a honey soy sesame popcorn crayfish. So we'll head back home, we'll prep up these crays and have a nice big feed. Big thanks to Greg for taking us out
over there.
Legend. Pleasure. And there you go, guys. We'll see you back in the kitchen. Rightio, so we've gone out, we've done the whites run. The whites are my favorite crays to eat, so I'm looking forward to this. Now, everyone's done popcorn cray, but this is a little bit of a variation of it. I'm gonna make a beer batter that's gonna have some ginger beer in it, which is gonna add to my soy and sesame and honey dressing I'm gonna put over the top. Some soba noodles. This is a fast dish, super easy. We've just come back, we've been out in the boat all day. We just wanna have a quick snack, and this is how we're gonna do it. So, we've got our water on the boil. We've got some oil getting hot, ready for the cray to go in with the beer batter on it. So I'll start off by making this beer batter. Now, self-raising flour, always for beer batters. We'll put a dash of that in there. I've always told you that Carlton Mid is my favorite beer for making beer batters. So, I'm gonna mix this in. And just enough to make it stodgy. Okay, beautiful. So, we mix that up and we make a bit of a paste. And once we made a nice paste, I'm gonna add my, I'm gonna have to open this. Just forgot, it's pop. There we go. Bit of ginger beer. Now, I've got to be a little bit careful because ginger beer like this has a lot of sugar in it and it's gonna color the batter up fast. But it doesn't really matter because we're gonna boil the cray off first and we kind of want that batter to get that lovely golden color. So that's how we're gonna achieve it today. So, mix this through into a thick batter. Oh, the smell of that batter with the ginger beer in it is incredible. All right, so that's pretty much that done. We'll put that to the side. Next step, we've got to get our cray in. Now, this guy's gone to sleep, so he's ready to go in. In he goes. Now, while he boils, over here you can see I've got a few things. I've got a sesame soy dressing, and this is a Kewpie product. I love this. This is a roasted sesame dressing. I've been putting it on everything. You can buy it from like Coles. You can dip stuff in it. It's just really tasty. It's one of the best, best sauces I've had that I haven't had to make. So, bit of soy sauce. Oh, I got a bit of soba noodle in there. Bit of soy sauce in there. All right, that will do. Now, the honey thickens this up, so you want a good amount of honey in there. I'm gonna thicken that glaze up beautifully. Now, you can see I've just basically tried to thicken up my soy sauce with a bit of honey. I'll add a little bit more soy, a little bit more honey. You want it to be nice and sweet. And that's basically where we're at with that. Good pile of sesame seed in there. And that is ready for our beer battered cray to go into. All right. Yeah. That, look, this is how simple this is. This is one of those dishes, nice and easy. You can do it on your way home. Grab yourself something from the local IGA, like we did, and boil it up. Now, the crayfish, we're not trying to cook it all the way through. We're just trying to cook the shell enough that the meat releases from the shell and it just makes your life a little bit easier at the end. So I'll do a couple more minutes on that. We'll see how hot this is looking. Yeah, so that's plenty hot enough. All right, I'm just gonna take this guy and cool him down on our hose because we are outside. We're doing it a bit rough out here. Just give me one sec. You can probably hear my young fella running around. It's a beautiful, beautiful day today, isn't it, young fella? This is young Eli. He's come to check out. He loves the crayfish. He loves any fish we bring home. He'll eat anything too, won't ya? Yeah. All right, so I've just taken the head off. Put that there for the dogs to have a look at. There you go, no, she doesn't want it. And we basically just crack the shell like that.
Smell it, Dad.
She likes to smell the crayfish?
Yeah.
She does, mate. Alright, so you can see how easy, even though this isn't cooked, you can just see how easy it came out of the shell. Now you can take the cray out of the shell raw, but it's a pain in the bum, if I'm being honest. It takes forever, and half the time you don't end up getting as much meat, it gets stuck in the shell. So, we now have our tail. So, I'm gonna cut this into rings. Pieces like this, so it's all gonna fall apart, it's fine. Nice pieces. Don't stress too much about it, just wanna sort of make them all the same thickness so they cook the same thickness. Now, this is gonna turn into quite a lot because once you add the beer batter to it, it's gonna puff up, obviously. So, we've done everything we need to here. Now, our cray that boiled in there, that water is now crayfish flavored, which is great, because we drop our soba noodles in there. All right, now they come in these little packs like this. You just peel the paper off them. Oop, don't mind them dropping everywhere. Peel the paper off them, drop them in like that. 4 minutes. Well, that's what they say, but like anything, you cook it till it's ready. All right, let's let them cook for a second. Should we put the crayfish in here now? Yeah. All right, that goes in there. Stir it all around with this because I don't want to make any more mess. No, no more mess. And let's just do a test run on this.
Might
did
that mess up the
white fish? Yeah, that's nice. It's good heat. Greg, would you be able to just run inside and just grab me a plate?
I can do that.
Just near where you got the glassware from. Crayfish popcorn is so good because it's one of those dishes that if you didn't get many crays, you'll feed everybody. So a couple of crays will do, you know, 6-7 people, especially just for a, not a huge meal, a snack. I'll just make sure that this isn't gonna catch. We'll just keep dropping them in there. Okay, that's beautiful. That's fine, just turn it down a touch. Ellie's into everything. Now, Ellie's my chocolate lab over there, and she literally will eat anything that you put in front of her. Look at the colour of those from that ginger beer. Just gorgeous colour. And ginger flavour. You can't really go wrong, can you? Baby, I'm just going to get you to step back a bit, all right? Because it's very hot. Good boy. All right, put those on the plate there. We now need to get these soba noodles out. It's been around about 3 or 4 minutes, I'd say. Let's get them in, drain them. Now, these here, drain them off, and you can shave cucumber through them. Do whatever you want. They're buckwheat, the beautiful flavour. So I really love using them, especially in Asian cuisine, a bit of coriander. So we'll put them into our bowl. We will grab the this one here, the roasted sesame dressing that I absolutely love. Super convenient for quick meals like this. All right, tongs. Give that a quick toss through. Beautiful flavors in that. And that can go into the middle of the bowl. Wonderful. Next lot. All of our crayfish into a lovely dressing. Toss it all around. Now look at that, look at the colors. Make sure that you get every little bit of it coated in there, just like that. You're getting a lot of sesame flavors in this dish, and that's what you want. You want to basically really hit home with the classic honey sesame flavor, and the soy sauce just basically thins out the honey a little bit and just adds another dimension. So I'll put another quick dash of sesame seeds over the top. And look, I'm not even going to garnish that with anything. That is just a nice, simple snack to put around the table for everyone to enjoy. And I knocked it up in no time. So Next time you're out, if you're out doing the whites and you want to try a different recipe that's super easy, that's the one. So Greg, mate, can we get you over here? Do you want to make sure this is all right? Or just make sure I'm not talking trash to the camera?
If you insist, Kip.
I'm going to join you on fingers a piece all right? There. Yeah, I reckon, mate, yeah. It's hot. It's so yummy.
I think I need a second opinion.
Go on. Oh, just mate. Make sure.
That is so good.
So easy. And the ginger from the ginger beer is there. It's strong and it's lovely with a cray.
Absolutely.
Nice one. Well, thanks again, Greg. Cheers for taking us out, mate. It was a bloody good trip. And yeah, there you go. Hope you have a crack at this one. Cheers, guys.
Hey, where you go?
It is actually that good.